yes, fellow veterans. I'm not quite sure how to follow that introduction. I hope my remarks can, in some small way, live up to Sean's high expectations. About 15 years ago, a woman named Carmela LaSpada asked a group of school children in Washington, D.C. what Memorial Day meant to them. They talked it over and decided that's the day the pool opens. For too many Americans, Memorial Day now means a three-day weekend, the time to open the beach house or put the boat in the water, or the day the pool opens. You should be very proud, every one of you, of being here today, because your presence honors the true meaning of Memorial Day. You honor the memories of our fallen comrades. To put this in perspective, if every man, woman, and child in Rhode Island died tomorrow, the death toll would still be about 100,000 less than the number of Americans who have died in the nation wars, 1.1 billion. Sadly, many Americans have lost this connection with our history. All too many of us today view military service as an abstraction, images you see on television, movies. Miss LaSpada, who's that woman I was telling you about, wanted to show those children why they are free and who paid for their freedom. She started the Moment of Remembrance campaign. She would like to see all Americans observe 1 minute of silence at 3 p.m. on Memorial Day to honor those who sacrificed their lives for us. Unfortunately, these efforts have not borne fruit the way she hoped. We are a busy nation of 300 million souls, all going somewhere and doing something all the time. Memorial Day, as many of you know, started shortly after the Civil War. For many years, stores closed and people gathered for picnics and parades with a patriotic theme. Today, families may still gather for those picnics, but for many, the spirit of remembrance is absent. I come from a long line of citizen soldiers. My great-granduncle, Terence McQueen, an Irish immigrant, served with the Rhode Island Volunteers during the Civil War. My grandfather, Patrick Lennon, served in the Rhode Island Militia during the Spanish-American War. And my uncle, Leo Gaffney, from West Warwick, served with the AEF during World War I. My father, also Frank Lennon, participated in the Salerno, Anzio, and Southern France landings in World War II. As a young boy, all I wanted to do when I grew up was to be a soldier. The desire was focused by a TV series while I was in high school, which was called The West Point Story. And after that, getting into the military academy was my only goal. I can remember my mother driving over to baseball practice at Hope High School, pressing my letter of appointment up against the chain link fence. While stationed in Berlin shortly after the wall went up in the early 1960s, I experienced a chilling link to World War II that Sean mentioned, serving as an officer of the guard at Spandau Prison. Also in Berlin, when I was an exchange officer to the British Army, I remember the colonel of the regiment on Remembrance Day, which is the British equivalent of Veterans Day, telling me a story that stuck with me to this day. As a young man during World War II, he served in Gibraltar. There's an old guardhouse near the Rock, probably constructed during some Napoleonic War. During some interminable watch many years ago, a British soldier had etched these words in one of the stone walls. In times of trouble and of war, God and the soldier all adore. But when the war is over and trouble's righted, God is forgotten and the old soldier slighted. If you'll bear with me for a few minutes, I'd like to elaborate on that theme here today. Fast forward to 1967. Fast forward to 1967. As a 25-year-old captain, I went to Vietnam, first with the 173rd Airborne Brigade, and then with the Green Berets, whose headgear I proudly wear today. I've been asked to provide you with a taste of the Vietnam experience, an almost impossible task in just a few minutes. Increasing the complexity of that task is the aftermath of the war, which split our societies in some way that has never healed. But let me start by trying to dispel a few myths. Myth number one, most Vietnam vets were drafted. The truth is that 2/3 of the men who served in Vietnam were volunteers. On the other hand, Two-thirds of the men who served during World War II were drafted. Approximately 70% of those killed in Vietnam were volunteers. Myth number two, a disproportionate number of blacks were killed in the Vietnam War. Truth, 86% of the men who died in Vietnam were Caucasians, 12.5% were black. That's proportional to the population figures at that time. Myth number three, the war was fought largely by the poor and uneducated. In truth, our Vietnam veterans were the best educated forces our nation had ever sent into combat. 79% had a high school education or better. And as far as casualties go, servicemen who went to Vietnam from well-to-do areas had a slightly elevated risk of dying because they were more likely to be pilots or infantry officers, typically groups that experienced large or high casualties. Surveys conducted after the war also revealed that 91% of Vietnam veterans, and I see a number of you out here today, say they are glad they served. 74% of Vietnam veterans said they would serve again, even knowing the results. More than 25 years ago, renowned political reporter Myra McPherson wrote, "Above all, Vietnam was a war that asked everything of a few and nothing of most in America." Unfortunately, the same can be said for our current conflicts in Iraq and Afghanistan, unlike World War II, where everyone sacrificed. Another factor was the miracle of television. Marshall McLuhan, the famous Canadian educator, wrote, "Television brought the brutality of war into the comfort of the living room. Vietnam was lost in the living rooms of America, not on the battlefields of Vietnam." Nothing happened in Vietnam that has not happened a hundredfold or a thousandfold in the history of warfare. In previous wars, especially World War II, even personal mail from soldiers was censored before it was sent. As a result, many of the nitty-gritty horrors of war were sanitized. Lost in the media furor is the fact that Vietnam was the first American war where there was no military censorship. That combination of total press freedom and the march of technology brought the realities of combat into America's living rooms night after night. As a result, the deadly fear of civilian casualties resulted in politically imposed rules of engagement. In certain areas of the country, we could not fire on the enemy unless they had fired at us first, which meant we would suffer the first casualties. This is like changing the rules of boxing so that you could not take a swing at your opponent unless he hit you first. But the armchair generals back home were fixated on how wars had been fought generations ago. This time, however, many of the enemy did not wear uniforms. Some Purple Hearts were earned as a result of wounds inflicted by women or children. Also, there were areas we could not bomb, so the enemy would retreat to those areas, resupply, and recover. We fought with one hand tied behind our backs. Because I spoke French, the second language of Vietnam, I assisted in the interrogation of many prisoners of war. They said they hung on in the most miserable of conditions because they believed they could outlast us. Their leaders did not need to invent propaganda. They simply read translations of American news articles. Every single POW I questioned firmly believed that our will to fight would erode because of anti-war sentiment on the home front. Now, this is a personal opinion, but I'm convinced that the anti-war effort had the opposite effect from what was intended. Instead of shortening the war, saving American lives, it fueled the enemy's will to resist, extended the war, and ended up costing us more casualties than had we presented a united front in the first place. In 1995, the Wall Street Journal interviewed a colonel from the general staff of the North Vietnamese Army. He said, and I quote, "Every day our leadership would listen to world news to follow the growth of the American anti-war movement. We believe that American commanders had their hands tied by political factors. Your generals could never deploy a maximum force for greatest military effect. Through dissent and protest, America lost the ability to mobilize a will to win." People often ask why all these soldiers put themselves in harm's way when it became apparent that we would not be allowed to win the war militarily. When it came right down to it, none of us were viewing the war from a political perspective. We simply fought and died for each other. Yes, we are here today to honor our dead. But sometimes, perhaps selfishly, I think we place too much emphasis on honoring the dead and not enough on remembering why they died. The same goes for those who serve and live among us today. One of the great quotes from that came out of the whole Vietnam experience was from a war correspondent named Michael Herr. He wrote, "All the wrong people remember Vietnam. I think all the people who remember it should forget it, and all the people who forgot it should remember it." Reach out to a friend or neighbor, especially one who served in Vietnam, and say thank you. It's not too late. A significant difference between Vietnam and the War on Terror is that the citizens of this great nation have learned to support our military personnel, even if they don't support the war. But it's strange that we can enjoy such comfortable lives and yet think so little of the cost of that comfort. Unless a friend or relative is a casualty, we give almost no thought to war or to conflict or much else that happens beyond the boundaries of our immediate communities. When a crisis rears, however, and a threat intrudes on this sheltered suburban way of life, everyone expects our military to be there to take care of us. For every publicized SEAL Team 6 success, there are thousands of unknown small actions that take place every day. Actions that combine to allow the rest of us to sleep in peace. I would argue the greatest social service a nation can provide its people is to keep them alive and keep them free. More than 2,400 years ago, the Athenian leader Pericles offered a tribute to the fallen heroes of Greece that is just as applicable today. He wrote, "Not only are they commemorated by columns and inscriptions, but there dwells also an unwritten memorial of them, graven not on stone, but in the hearts of men." I'd like to close with a short poem by Charles M. Provost. Some of you may have heard these words before, but they deserve to be heard again, especially on this day. "It is the soldier, not the reporter, who has given us freedom of the press. It is the soldier, not the poet, who has given us freedom of speech. It is the soldier, not the campus organizer, who has given us the freedom to demonstrate. It is the soldier who salutes the flag, who serves beneath the flag, and whose coffin is draped by the flag, who has won the protesters' freedom to burn the flag."